ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। मन्यसे यदि तच्छक्यम् मया द्रष्टुमिति प्रभो योगेश्वर ततो मे त्वं दर्शयात्मानमव्ययम्। वर्ड बाय वर्ड ट्रांसलेशन। मन्यसे, यू थिंक, यदि, इफ, तत, दैट, शक्यम, इज एबल, मया, बाय मी, द्रष्टुम, टू बी सीन, इति, दस, प्रभो, ओ लॉर्ड, योगेश्वरा, ओ लॉर्ड ऑफ ऑल मिस्टिक पावर, ततः, देन, मी, मे, अंटु मी, त्वं, यू, दर्शया, शो, आत्मानं, योरसेल्फ, अव्ययम्, इटर्नल। ट्रांसलेशन एंड पर्पोर्ट बाय श्रील प्रभुपाद। इफ यू थिंक that I am able to behold your cosmic form, O my Lord, O Master of all mystic power, then kindly show me that unlimited universal self. Purport. It is said that one can neither see, hear, understand, nor perceive the Supreme Lord Krishna by material senses. But if one is engaged in loving transcendental service to the Lord from the beginning, then one can see the Lord by revelation. Every living entity is only a spark, a spiritual spark. Therefore, it is not possible to see or to understand the Supreme Lord. Arjuna, as a devotee, does not depend on his speculative strength. Rather, he admits his limitations as a living entity and acknowledges Krishna's inestimable position. Arjuna could understand that for a living entity, it is not possible to understand the unlimited infinite. If the infinite reveals himself, then it is possible to understand the nature of the infinite by the grace of the infinite. The word Yogeshwara is also very significant here because the Lord has inconceivable power. If He likes, He can reveal Himself by His grace, although He is unlimited. Therefore, Arjuna pleads for the inconceivable grace of Krishna. He does not give Krishna orders. Krishna is not obliged to reveal Himself unless one surrenders fully in Krishna consciousness and engages in devotional service. Thus, it is not possible for persons who depend on the strength of their mental speculations to see Krishna. Om Ajnanatimirandasya Jnananjanashalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Manovishtam स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूप कदा महयं ददाति स्वपदांतिकं। वंदेहं श्रीगुरु श्रीयुत पदकमलं श्रीगुरुन् वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सहगण रघुनाथांवितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजन सहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधा कृष्णपादान सहगण ललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्ण करुणा सिंधु दीनबंधो जगतपते गोपेश गोपिका कांता राधा कांता नमोस्तुते तप्त कांचन गौरांगी राधे वृंदावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरि प्रिये वांछा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्यैव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी इति नामिने नमस्ते सरस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे
हरे कृष्णा। मन्यसे यदि तत्शक्यं मया द्रष्टुमिति प्रभो योगेश्वर ततो मे त्वं दर्शयात्मानम् अव्ययम्। If you think that I am able to behold your cosmic form, O my Lord, O Master of all mystic power, then kindly show me that unlimited universal self. So here this verse is being spoken by Arjuna after having heard the opulences of Krishna in the previous chapter, where Krishna describes in detail about his unlimited opulences. And the chapter is entitled Opulence of the Absolute, the previous chapter. In a large number of verses, Krishna describes about his various opulences, that I am this, I am that. Among the Vedas, I am Samaved. Among the mountains, I am Meru. Among immovable beings, I am Himalaya. Among the letters, I am Om. Like this, there are many, many opulences that he describes. Having heard all those opulences, Arjuna is fully convinced. He doesn't have any doubts. Nevertheless, he is requesting Krishna to show his universal form. And Srila Prabhupada writes in the previous purports that this is for those people who are atheists and may not believe. So for their benefit, Arjuna is requesting Krishna to show, to display his form. He has already heard all those opulences and now he is requesting to show those things. He wants to see all those things. The unlimited opulences, of course, Krishna told Arjuna that it's impossible to describe my opulences because they are unlimited. But I will describe some important ones. It says pradhanyatah, some important ones because they are unlimited, so it can never end. There is no limit to the opulences of Krishna. It's not that whatever he has mentioned in this 10th chapter, that's all the opulences Krishna has. Krishna has unlimited opulences. But he told that I will describe some primary ones, some main opulences I will describe, but they are unlimited. And then at the end said, anything you see, anything beautiful, anything shining, attractive, consider this as one of my opulence. They are just a spark of my splendor. So Arjuna is now requesting Krishna to show his universal form, where he can actually see with his own eyes. He can see all these various opulences. He can see everything in front of his eyes. But the mood in which Arjuna is asking this question, we need to see in this verse. He says, manyase yadi, means if you think that I am capable of beholding your form. She is not ordering Krishna that, no, please show, then I will accept you. That is not the way Arjuna is asking this question. We hear many people ask this question that, if God exists, then show me God. Then I will believe. And if you cannot show me God, then God does not exist. This is how many people in this world, they put forth their argument. That if you cannot show me God, then I don't believe God exists. And it means God does not exist. Because I cannot see. So I can't see, because therefore God does not exist. That is their logic. And Srila Prabhupada was also asked this kind of question when he was here. He was traveling all over the world, and many people, they will put forth these questions. So Srila Prabhupada used to say that, yes, God exists and you can see God, but do you have the eyes to see God? God is not something who can be perceived or seen by the material senses. In the very beginning of the purport to this verse, Srila Prabhupada writes that, it is said that one can neither see, hear, understand, nor perceive the Supreme Lord, Krishna, by the material senses. It's not possible. It's not possible to see. So, before we discuss the details of the purport, let us look at the verse, word by word. It says, manyase yadi tat shakyam maya drashtum iti prabhu. O Krishna, if you think that I am capable, I am eligible to see, then yogeshwara tato, therefore me tvam darshaya, then please show me your inexhaustible, unlimited form. You please show me. But if you think I am eligible to see, means the discretion to reveal yourself lies with you. That's what Arjuna is saying. He's not saying that unless you show yourself to me, I will not accept you. That is not his asking. If you think I am eligible, then please show your form. So this is not an order. This is a begging with humility. The mood of asking question. And most of the people who ask these questions to show me God, they don't have this mood. So they are not eligible to see God. Before we even, this is a very big question. Can we see God? Many people ask this question. Or have you seen God? Has Prabhupada seen God? People ask this question. Who has seen God? Nobody can see God. Like all these different ways people ask these questions. But before we dwell into this, we should understand first, who is God? What are we trying to see? At least have some understanding of who is God. and then we talk about seeing him. God is not something, any object like we see here, like this desk, this book, this microphone, this fan, this tube light, this glass, this door. He is not like an object, mundane object that we can perceive through our senses. Within the purview of our sense perception, we don't have anything that is unlimited or that is infinite. Everything that we see, like this chair, it is a finite object. It has a limited space, it takes weight, mass, whatever. It is limited in space, in time, place. The camera, the watch, the speaker system, the fan, anything we see. The trees, the plants, even the sun, the moon, the mountains, the road, the buildings, the big, big aeroplanes, the trains. This is all we see. And everything is finite. And here we are talking about something that is altogether, it's a different category. It doesn't fall into the category of things that we are used to perceiving. We perceive so many things, but none of those things fall in the category of God. It is altogether a very different concept. It's a finite versus infinite. We have no idea of what infinite means. How can we perceive God? We have not perceived anything that is infinite. Anything that we perceive, we can think of anything. Nothing is infinite. Everything is finite. All people, finite, small, limited. We are all limited. So that is one thing we must understand. That here we are talking about something is altogether a very different category. Second thing, when we need to have access to something which belongs to a higher domain, then we need the grace of that domain to get access to that. We can't perceive things of a higher domain from our level. Even in this material world, we see as living entities, the human beings are in a higher domain than non-living beings, or even animals, we can say. A little higher consciousness is there. So, it's more likely that human beings can have a better understanding of non-living beings and other animals. But the non-living beings and animals, they possibly cannot have a good understanding. Non-living beings cannot have even any understanding, and animals can have very limited understanding of what human beings are. Because human beings are supposed to be in a little higher consciousness than animals. So even in this world we can see, human beings, because they are in a higher domain, they can perceive things that are in lower domain. But this desk cannot understand or cannot perceive what humans are. So if humans and these objects needs to have a relationship, it's the humans who have to create that relationship. It has to come from the higher domain to the lower. Not from lower to higher. Similarly, Krishna is in even higher domain. The God is in a higher domain. So if he wants, he allows, then we can have access to him. Not by our own mental speculation or by our own endeavors. We cannot have. we are trying to reach something which is beyond our domain, we need the grace of that domain. Otherwise we cannot understand. There are two methods of understanding. One is Aroha Pantha, other is Avaroha Pantha. The ascending process and descending process. The ascending process means we, with our own intelligence, our own powers, we try to speculate and try to understand. But with that method we can understand things that are in our domain or in lower domain. We cannot understand anything that is in a higher domain. With all this ascending process, the modern science that has developed, it has only ended up dealing with objects that are in lower domain. That is matter. That is why this is called material science, because it deals with matter only. It has no idea of what is consciousness, what is spirit, what is God. There is no idea. In the whole modern science, this topic is undealt with. It's not dealt with. It only talks about what is matter, how to analyze matter, how to manipulate matter, how to control matter, and how to create more things with matter. Because matter falls in a lower domain than consciousness, than spirit. Spirit and matter, these are the two things that first we need to understand before we enter into spiritual life. So, with all these amazing developments of modern science, which is mesmerizing and people are bewildered and totally controlled by it, but if we look at it, it's all about matter. It's all about matter. It's all manipulation of matter, understanding of matter, controlling the matter, the laws of matter. It's all about that. So if we have to understand something of a higher domain, it's a different process altogether. So by this ascending process, we will not be able to do it. By ascending process, we can only deal with something that is of a lower domain. If we have to understand something of a transcendental domain, then we need the mercy and grace from that domain to be able to have access to that. That is called descending process. Avaroha Pantha. Shri Prabhupada, this is what Shri Prabhupada has been trying to say in these verses in many ways. He says the same thing again and again, in one way, then in another way, then in another way. So that if we don't get it in one way, we get in the second way. If not in the second way, we get in the third way. If not in the third way, we get in the fourth way. And there will be people who will not get even after n number of ways. So, now coming back to this topic of seeing God. Why do we want to see God? That is also a question. Do we want to see God to establish the fact that, oh, if I see, then only He exists. If I don't see, then He does not exist. Is that the purpose? We need to see what is the intention before we ask this question. If this kind of intention is there, unless I see, God doesn't exist. Then it's not going to work. We won't be qualified and we will not see, but that does not mean that God doesn't exist. Devotees also want to see God. There we have verses in Srimad Bhagavatam, any places where it has been mentioned. Devotees very eager to see God. Dhruva Maharaj was doing tapasya to see God. And so intense austerity, was not eating anything, not drinking anything, standing, so austere to see God. Pandavas are eager to see God. And Vrindavan Brajavasi is eager to see Krishna. Narada Muni always eager to see Krishna. So these devotees, when they are eager to see Krishna, it's out of pure love for Him. There is a big difference. In Bhagavatam, the word, the phrase that comes is Krishna Darshan Lalasa. It's a lalasa, very intense eagerness to see Krishna. It's out of pure love. And that is the qualification to see Krishna. When one has this pure love and eyes are anointed with love, then one gets that qualification to see Krishna. In Brahma Samhita, it verse comes, Premanjana Shurita Bhakti Vilochanena Santah Sadaiva Hridayeshu Vilokayanti Yam Shyama Sundara Achintya Guna Swarupam Govinda Madhi Purusham Tamaham Bhajame. Premanjana Churita, the eyes are anointed with love, so with frame, with that love in the heart, then one can see Krishna. So that is the qualification. The qualification is not any mundane scholarship, high level of intelligence, material advancement, none of these qualify one to see Krishna. It's only when Krishna reveals Himself, and Krishna reveals Himself only to those who are devotees, who have love for Krishna. He says in Bhagavad Gita, previous verses in the 7th chapter, Naham prakash sarvasya yoga maya samabritam Moodho ayam nabhijanati loko mamajam avyayam. I am not revealed to everyone. Na aham prakasha sarvasya. I am not revealed to everyone. I don't reveal myself to everyone. I am yoga maya samabritam. I am covered by my yoga maya potency. And those who are foolish, they cannot understand. They moodho ayam na abhijanati. They don't know me. Even if Krishna comes in, Krishna walks here in this world, people will still not be able to see Him, will not be able to understand Him. Even when He was here 5,000 years ago with the Pandavas and Kauravas, not everybody understood who is Krishna. Very few could understand. Very few. Duryodhana and company, they could not. Very few could understand, even though He was present. Because the qualification is not that with these eyes we see something that is Krishna. It's not that. Krishna is revealed to those who have pure love for Him. It's the purity of the heart where Krishna is revealed. It's not an external vision. It's about the revelation in the heart. And is revealed to devotees. And if we can see, this example also is given, that if we want to see sun, we cannot have any torch light and try to find where the sun is. We can see sun only with the help of sun, not by the help of anything else. Sun cannot be seen. It's night time, we can't take torch and go and find where the sun is. Only when sun rises in the morning, we can see the sun. So when sun Himself reveals, sun is seen. Similarly, when Krishna Himself reveals, Krishna is like sun. Krishna surya sama maya haya andhakar jaha Krishna taha nahi maya radhikar. So Krishna is like the sun. So when Krishna reveals, we will see Krishna. If sun doesn't rise in the east, then we can't see sun. No matter, we can't have 1 million bulbs to see sun. We can't see. Only when sun rises in the east, we can see sun. Similarly, when Krishna rises, Krishna reveals, he can be seen, he can be perceived. And to what degree he reveals, to that degree only we can understand him. He is unlimited, so nobody actually can understand Krishna fully. Nobody can understand. So to his devotees, he reveals in whatever way, in whatever form, in whatever mood, and the devotee understands in that way. So it's all his power, it's all his discretion to whoever, in whatever way, to whatever degree he wants to reveal, he enables that person to perceive him. Even in this, Arjuna, when he requests, then Krishna, being pleased with him, he reveals, but he gives, before that he gives a divine vision. And with this you can see my form. So this is Krishna. We cannot demand that Krishna must come before me. We can only act in such a way that Krishna will be pleased and he will reveal. Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur said, don't try to see Krishna, rather act in such a way that Krishna will like to see you. So devotees actually are not very eager to see Krishna, rather they are more eager to act in such a way that Krishna is pleased with our service. In every day, whatever we do, our actions should be such that they are pleasing to Krishna. He knows everything we are doing. He is in the heart of everyone. He is always there. He is always there. It's not that he is not there, he is missing from this world, and sometime he will come and he will reveal. Devotee always feels the presence of Krishna everywhere. Wherever devotee is, he feels the presence, because devotee is never alone. He is always there. Krishna is always there with him. Devotee lives his life always in this remembrance, this understanding that Krishna is always there with him. He is never alone. That is what is relationship. The whole personal philosophy that we have of Gaudiya Vaishnava philosophy is that Krishna is a person and we are persons and we have a relationship with Krishna. It's an eternal relationship. And Krishna is never lost to devotees. Devotee is always there with devotees all the time. So a devotee is not very eager that, okay, I want to see Krishna here all the time. Rather, he is more eager to serve, to act in such a way that is pleasing to him. Whatever instructions Krishna gives in Bhagavad Gita, in Srimad Bhagavatam, a devotee should try to follow that. Try to live his life in such a way that Krishna is pleased with our actions. And then, by his mercy, whatever he wants, wherever he wants, he will take. A devotee is surrender. The qualification is surrenderance. That is needed. So if you look at the purport, Prabhupada is saying that one can neither see, hear, understand or perceive the Supreme Lord by material senses. We cannot see because material senses have the ability to perceive something that is material. Material senses can never perceive anything that is spiritual or beyond matter. That is why they are material senses. They are meant to perceive only material things, and Krishna is not in that category. Even material senses cannot perceive soul. What about super soul? With material senses, we can't see even soul. We can only see body. We can't see soul. So what about super soul? That's even beyond.
But if one is engaged in loving devotional service to the Lord from the beginning, then one can see the Lord by revelation.
But if one is engaged in loving devotional service, that is the same thing. Premanjana kshurita bhakti vilochanena. A devotee who is engaged in loving service to Krishna, he always has a loving heart. And then Krishna is revealed. Santaha sadaiva hridayeshu vilokayanti. They see Krishna where? Hridayeshu, in the heart. In the heart they see.
Every living entity is only a spiritual spark, therefore it is not possible to see or to understand the Supreme Lord. We are very tiny actually. The thing to understand is how small and how insignificant we are. In comparison to the whole creation, we are nothing actually. There are so many living entities. People are being born, people are dying. Universes are being created and they are being annihilated. Where we exist? We are nowhere. We are insignificant. This understanding is very important. We are very small. And we are talking about seeing who is infinite. Who controls all these universes where there are unlimited number of people. And we are just one of them. Therefore, it is not possible to see or to understand the Lord. As a devotee, Arjuna as a devotee does not depend on his speculative strength. Arjuna is not depending on his strength to see Krishna. Rather, he admits his limitations as a living entity and acknowledges Krishna's inestimable position. Krishna's position is inestimable. We cannot estimate. Inconceivable. There's no words by which we can properly describe Krishna or estimate Krishna, his strength, his opulences. That's the meaning of infinite. It's the meaning of infinite. We can never reach to the limit of Krishna's opulence.
Arjuna could understand that for a living entity it is not possible to understand the unlimited infinite. It is not possible.
If the infinite reveals himself, then it is possible to understand the nature of the infinite by the grace of the infinite. If the revelation has to come from above. If Krishna is pleased with someone, he reveals himself and then that devotee understands who is Krishna.
The word Yogeshwara is always very significant here because the Lord has inconceivable powers. Yogeshwara, Krishna has this name Yogeshwara. So Arjuna is addressing Krishna as Yogeshwara. You are Yogeshwara, you are inconceivable. So you can reveal yourself. You are Yogeshwara. You have all mystic powers. Inconceivable. If he likes, he can reveal himself by his grace, although he is unlimited. Therefore, Arjuna pleads for the inconceivable grace of Krishna. This is a very important thing. The grace is not something that we can demand. That Krishna, I must get the grace of Krishna. Grace is unconditional. And it comes only when the other party is pleased by our services, by our mood, our attitude, our level of surrender. Then grace comes. Grace is something that descends. It comes from above, it descends. It's not something that can be demanded, that I have done this much, now I must get the grace of Krishna. It cannot be demanded. We can only pray for it. That's all. He does not give Krishna orders. Arjuna is not giving Krishna orders.
Krishna is not obliged to reveal himself unless one surrenders fully in Krishna consciousness and engages in devotional service.
When people say, please have God appear before me, then I will accept. Krishna is not something that we can order and he will appear. And if someone appears, then he is not God. God is not so cheap that anybody can, any random person can demand and God will appear to prove that he exists. If God has to appear on anyone's whimsical demand to prove that he exists, then that cannot be God. God exists irrespective of whether someone accepts him or does not accept. His existence is independent of someone's acknowledging it or not acknowledging it. He exists independently. It's in my interest to accept him, to approach him. Thus, it is not possible for persons who depend on the strength of their mental speculations to see Krishna. Very clearly, it is said. So those who ask these kind of questions, they should be asked to read this purport. Those who demand that I must see you show God to me, then I will believe that God exists. The existence of God is not dependent on somebody's acknowledging or accepting or not. God exists independently. Our existence is dependent on Krishna's existence, but Krishna's existence is not dependent on our existence. It's not like a political party where the democracy where all people, when they agree, then somebody is the head. When they don't agree, then he is no longer the head. Right? That's what is democracy. Somebody is prime minister because majority accepts. If majority does not accept, then he will not be a prime minister. But that is not the case with Krishna. Krishna exists. Whether we accept it or we don't accept it. Krishna exists. He existed. He exists. He will continue to exist in the future. He is the one and only one God. From time immemorial, he has been existing, and from up to eternity, he will continue to exist. And he exists independently without anybody else's existence. And everything else that exists in the creation is part and parcel of him, is an extension of him. It exists because of him. Nothing exists separate from Krishna also. There is nothing that is also that is separately and independently existing, which has independent existence other than Krishna. So we must understand who is God, and only way to approach God is through his grace. And how to invoke his grace is the process of devotional service. This is the process that has been prescribed by chanting the holy name, by hearing the topics about Krishna, by engaging ourselves in the process of devotional service. By these processes, we invoke the grace of Krishna. These processes are meant to enable us to become a recipient of the grace. And when that happens, then we will see Krishna. We will have, Krishna will reveal himself in the heart of devotees. And that is the only process. There is no other way or any other mystic power or mystic process or any other thing that we can do to approach Krishna. Devotional service, by devotional service, we cannot demand that I am performing this process, so I must see Krishna. By devotional service, we can only hope that Krishna will be pleased and one day he will shower his grace upon me. That is the only thing we can do. And that is sufficient for us. And that is the best thing that we can do. And our existence is purified, is meaningful if we do this. The process of devotional service is what we are supposed to follow. And the primary thing in this process of devotional service is chanting the holy name. Chanting this Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. It starts with this chanting. And this process has the power to enable us in due course to become a recipient of the grace of Krishna. And then our life will be successful. So thank you very much. We will end here. If anyone has any comments or questions, Hare Krishna.